There's an old socialist song, the socialist ABC, that some people may know, that written by Alex Glasgow, and it begins with A is for the, it's for alienation that made me the man that I am. B is for the boss who's a bastard, a bourgeois who don't give a damn. And it goes through the alphabet. C is for capitalism, D is for the dictatorship of the proletariat, and so on. We got to what I always found some of the most memorable lines in it. S is for sad Stalinism that gave us all such a bad name. And T is for Trotsky, the hero, who had to take all of the blame. And I have to confess that Trotsky was always my hero. I once wrote that Trotsky was a genius or something, and there was caused a controversy about whether Marxists should have the concept of genius or not. But anyway, he was extraordinary, and I've done a lot of meetings about Trotsky, and the problem with doing a meeting about Trotsky is that you just can't do him justice in one meeting. He's 10 meetings. I just summarise some of his world historic achievements. Right, in 1905, he's aged 26. He leads the 1905 revolution and is president of the Petrograd Soviet, the world's first workers' council or Soviet. Age 26. Frightening, isn't it? But, in 1914, he's one of the very small number of revolutionary socialists who stand out against the imperialist First World War, along with the other great names, Lenin, Luxembourg, Liebknecht, John McLean in Scotland, Connolly in Ireland, and so on. Trotsky is one of those who maintains an internationalist position, that one of the great dividing points in the history of the socialist movement, when the overwhelming majority of that movement, led by social democrats, supported their own countries in the imperialist slaughter. In 1917, he leads the greatest revolution in history, the October Revolution, along with Lenin, and he's actually again president of the Petrograd Soviet, and in that capacity, the principal organizer of the October insurrection itself. He goes on to lead the defense of that revolution in creating and leading the Red Army in the horrendous civil war that followed, when so many Western countries lined up to support the restoration of Tsarism and the Tsarist generals and so on in the terrible war of intervention that they inflicted on Russia. Trotsky leads the defense. At the same time, he's also playing a leading role in the foundation of the Third International, the Communist International. The highest point, actually, that the revolutionary socialist movement, the Marxist movement, has ever reached in terms of international organization. He writes its manifestos, he makes major speeches at its conferences, he's deeply involved in all its affairs. Then, from 1923 onwards, he leads the left opposition to the rise of Stalinism, over the question of workers' democracy, and particularly in opposition to the Stalinist theory of socialism in one country. He's exiled, first internally to Alma-Ata on the Chinese border, then he's kicked out of a Russian exile to Turkey, the Principal Islands of Turkey. What does he do there? Nurse his wounds? No. He writes one of the greatest, perhaps the greatest work of history of the 20th century, the history of the Russian Revolution. At the same time, he's also producing the best and foundational Marxist analysis of fascism and how to fight it, in a series of articles that are collected as The Struggle Against Fascism in Germany, and so on. He's doing these things at the same time. Right, then, in the rest of the 1930s, in conditions of desperate isolation, he produces a magnificent critique and indictment of Stalinism, the revolution betrayed, and continues the fight for international socialism through his attempt to build the Fourth International. And an achievement which he thought was the most important work of his life, although it was on the margins and he was completely isolated, and you won't read about it in the sort of standard history books. He defended authentic Marxism when it was being buried under a mountain of lies and slander. You know, when he was being vilified as a fascist, and you need to understand that, a bit of point about that. He was being vilified as a fascist, right, but in the Moscow trials. The point is not that Stalin accused him of being a fascist. The point is that in the workers' movement, if you were a Trotskyist, in the workers' movement in Burnley, or in the workers' movement in Madrid, or in the workers' movement in Mexico, large numbers of ordinary working class people believed this because they were loyal to Russia. So that's what that slander meant, you need to understand. Against that, and against that pressure, he defended authentic revolutionary Marxism, and because of that, we all stand on his shoulders, and so on. So those are the major achievements of Trotsky. In addition to that, you have a series of minor achievements, each of which would bear a meeting at Marxism. You know, the fact that while he's waging the Civil War, riding across Russia in his train, he also manages to write an incredible polemic, flawed in various respects, but nonetheless incredible, devastating polemic against Karl Kautsky, the so-called Pope of Marxism, leader of German social democracy, while he's in his train, fighting the Civil War. In 1923, he has a short holiday, the first holiday he's had since 1970. He writes one of the great books on literature and art, literature and revolution. Minor achievement. While he's doing all the rest of the stuff. Or later, when he's fighting for authentic Marxism, what did he write? The Manifesto for Free Revolutionary Art with Diego Rivera and André Breton. Minor achievement. Writes about a 350-page book on the Chinese Revolution, 1925-1927. Minor achievement. And I could go on, etc. with the minor achievements. Okay. So that gives you some idea of who we're talking about. But this meeting is about Trotsky and Trotskyism today, not just a historical figure. Now, one way I could do this meeting would be to do a survey of the Trotskyist movement since the death of Trotsky. And we could go all the way from, I suppose, the Socialist Party to the International Bolshevist Tendency, the two committees for the political committees for the Fourth International, or whatever they're called, and so on. I hope that isn't the meeting you thought I was going to do, because I ain't going to do that. What I want to talk about is what I think it means to be a Trotskyist today. Now, the first thing I'd say on that is it does not mean that you follow every word or line of Trotsky. And there's a very good reason, there's two good reasons why that's a silly thing to do. One is that whether we're talking about Marx or Lenin or Rosa Luxemburg or Leon Trotsky or whoever we're talking about, all the great Marxists make mistakes. They're human. We all make mistakes. History is not a simple matter, and so on. So it's completely foolish to follow every word that Trotsky said. For example, in 1934, Trotsky was in favour of entryism into the Social Democratic parties for various reasons. Doesn't mean to say we now all have to go off and join the Labour Party. You know, some people might be in favour of doing this, by the way, in Britain at various points in time. Anybody who suggested doing it in Ireland today would practically get lynched. I mean, madness to do it in Ireland today. It doesn't mean, for example, that because Trotsky said in 1938 in the transitional programme that further development of capitalism was impossible, that mankind's productive forces would stagnate and no reforms were possible, but you go around saying that in the 1950s, 60s and 70s the productive forces didn't develop in the biggest capitalist boom in history. Or that somehow or other they haven't developed in China. I mean, you know, that's because Trotsky said so. That's to reach the position that the one unfortunate good man but one unfortunate Trotsky agreed to it. Trotsky predicted that there would be international proletarian revolution before the end of the Second World War. When the end of the Second World War came around, James Cannon, leader of the Trotskyist movement in America, said, the war hasn't ended because the revolution. No, you have to face reality and so on. So it's not a question of repeat. Being a Trotskyist today is not a question of repeating every word that Trotsky said. What it is a question of doing, I think, is looking at what the main principles of his life, the guiding fundamental principles are, and applying them to the world today. And let's be clear what they are. They're pretty straightforward, and they run right through his activity. First, it means you're a revolutionary socialist. Trotsky, in his testament at the end of his life, said that for 43 years he'd been a revolutionary, for 42 years he'd fought under the banner of Marxism, and he will die a proletarian revolutionist. Right? What does that mean? It means, first of all, but throughout his life, and if you're a Trotskyist today, now, that the working class is the socialist class. The working class is the agent of socialist change. A. B, it means that change requires a revolution, the smashing of the capitalist state, right, and the creation of a worker state. Not its takeover, not running the system a bit better. Now, I say this, and I say it forcefully, because being a revolutionary socialist is not the same as being anti-capitalist. I'm in favour of people being anti-capitalist. I want to work with everyone who's an anti-capitalist, but it's not the same. It's not the same as being a good left-winger, or a decent socialist, or a good trade unionist. And so I'm in favour, I'm not a sectarian, I'm in favour of working with all those people. Tony Benn is an anti-capitalist, a good left-winger, a decent socialist, etc., 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 and all those kinds of things, and we should work with Tony Benn wherever we can, and we have worked with Tony Benn wherever he could, but he's not a Trotskyist, and to be a Trotskyist today is to be a revolutionary socialist. It's not the same, and that's something that needs to be said. Second thing, it means to be an internationalist. This was absolutely fundamental to Trotsky and Trotskyism from the first moment of his political life to the last moment. He always had an internationalist perspective on the Russian Revolution, that it would need to be the spark of an international revolution. He defended internationalism, I said, in the war, and crucially, he defended internationalism against the Stalinist notion of socialism in one country. Not only did he understand that you couldn't build socialism in one country, he understood that the notion that you could would corrupt the whole international communist movement. Because if you could do it in Russia, you could do it everywhere else. It would be the stepping stone to what in those days they called social patriotism, but towards a kind of, well, we have a British road to socialism and therefore we defend Britain. Or we have a French road to socialism and therefore we defend France. It turned out that all these different British, French, and other roads to socialism were all the same parliamentary road, but they also went with a softness towards nationalism and so on, and a turn towards reformism. Trotsky fought against that, and throughout he regarded the world as a whole, the international working class as a whole, and he saw the whole as the struggle, the class struggle, as an international struggle. It also means being, along with that internationalism, an opponent of imperialism and imperialist war. I don't know whether it makes me laugh or sick, when I hear Christopher Hitchens saying he's a fan of Trotsky's, or he endorses Trotsky, or he's got a weakness for Trotsky. I just find myself imagining what Trotsky would have said about Christopher Hitchens. I would have liked to have read that article. Christopher Hitchens, the apologist for US imperialism. He had a wonderful phrase about such people. He said they deserved, anybody, he said, who doesn't defend the oppressed, defend national liberation movements, support national liberation movements against unconditionally against imperialism and so on, they deserved to be branded with infamy, if not a bullet, was Trotsky's phrase, and I would have found a suitable one for Hitchens. or anybody similar. So it means being a thorough-going internationalist, a defender of the oppressed. The third thing, it means, again, absolutely central to Trotsky's whole life, means being a supporter of an advocate of permanent revolution. This was Trotsky's first major contribution to Marxist theory, his analysis of how the struggle against Tsarism, the struggle for democracy, for a bourgeois democratic revolution in Tsarist Russia, would grow over into a working class socialist revolution. He developed that view as an extreme minority, when even Lenin thought it wasn't a possibility, because the working class was a minority in Russia, the large majority were peasants and so on. And when the Mensheviks said that Russia would have to go through a bourgeois democratic revolution meant that it would have to be led by the bourgeois democrats, and therefore the working class should be restrained and held back in order not to put them off and so on, because of the stages theory and so on. It means supporting the theory of permanent revolution where it applies today. And it applies in many places today. It would apply in Palestine today for a whole period, and still in the sense it applied in Ireland. Most importantly, of course, at the moment it applies in Egypt. It means opposition to the stages theory that was so disastrous, say, in South Africa for the African National Congress, or would be so disastrous in Egypt if you said, no, all we do is establish democracy when we get rid of Mubarak and then we stop. We don't try and develop that into a socialist revolution. So it means being an advocate of permanent revolution wherever there are democratic tasks to be achieved by the working class. It means, of course, kind of goes without saying, but it means being an absolute anti-fascist, right? And I think basing the struggle against fascism on Trotsky's understanding of fascism. Not mechanical repetition is a point here. When Trotsky talked about forming a united front against fascism, he talked about a united front between a mass communist party and a mass social democratic party, both of which had fighting organizations and base among hundreds of thousands of workers. You can't repeat that today. Who would you be calling for this united front between? A united front against fascism with Miliband, who is refusing. I mean, you know, it doesn't fit, and there is no mass communist party, and so on. But it does mean understanding that you try to unite the workers' movement on as broad a basis as possible against fascism, because you understand what a deadly threat it was. And there have been many times in the history of the movement, and still, where people don't understand that fascism is a deadly threat to us all, and that it is qualitatively different from right-wing conservatism. You know, people throw the word around. You hear debates that, you know, say Erdogan in Turkey is a fascist because the police beat people up on the streets. The police beat people up on the streets under all capitalist regimes, not the same as being fascist, etc. If you had a fascist reaction in Turkey, you wouldn't have 10 people dead on the streets. You'd have 10,000 people dead on the streets. It's not the same. Not the same thing. And so on. So it means understanding that. It means understanding that there is a qualitative difference between the real Nazis, BNP, now many of the EDL and so on, and UKIP or right-wing Tories and so on. We owe all that to Trotsky. It means understanding that. Most of all, I would say, knitting all these things together, it means that we build a revolutionary party. Now, I don't mean that it's often associated with the idea of sectarianism. Don't mean it in a sectarian sense at all. Remember that Trotsky was also consistently an advocate of the United Front. He was, along with Lenin, major advocate of the United Front in the Communist International. That is a united front between the Communist Parties and the Social Democrats that included the Social Democrats who had betrayed the German Revolution and were responsible for the murder of Luxembourg and Liebknecht, against the capitalist offensive. Right, so he was for that, not because he had any illusions in the Social Democratic leaders, he had none whatsoever, but because he saw that it was necessary to unite the working class in struggle, and in doing and that a making a proposal of unity to the leaders was a way of uniting the working class in struggle. But equally, if he was in favour of the United Front there, and of course against fascism later, the United Front was never an agreement not to disagree. The United Front meant you unite in action, you reach agreement about practical actions to take, but the Marxist criticism of reformism continues. Right? You are forming a United Front, but in order to win in action the mass of workers away from the treacherous reformist leadership. So it was never a mutual non-aggression pact at a theoretical or political level, but at an agreement to fight. So he wasn't a sectarian, and I don't say it in a sectarian sense today at all, but he was absolutely committed to building a revolutionary party. Now, it's worth saying here that he wasn't always in the same way focused on building a revolutionary party. I'm going to come in under time, I think. He wasn't always focused on that in the same way. He was always a member of the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party from early stages. He was never, you know, an anarchist or people would say today autonomist and so on. But it was not his prime focus. Until 1917, he was for trying to achieve unity with the Mensheviks and so on. Right? He said himself that this was one of the worst mistakes he made in his life. Conversely, though, Lenin said of Trotsky that for once he understood there could be no unity with the Mensheviks. The Mensheviks were essentially, it was confused the language, but essentially left reformists. They would be the sort of people who today would be the fairly uncritical advocates of Syriza, I think, or something like that. I'm trying to place, there's no exact parallel, but they were essentially left reformists. Lenin says that once Trotsky understood that there could be no unity with the Mensheviks, there was no better Bolshevik than him. He realized this partly through the First World War and partly through the beginning of the experience of the Russian Revolution. But from that moment onwards, he was absolutely, absolutely clear on this question. It goes to the heart of something that is extremely relevant today, I think, in Britain. It's extremely relevant to us in Ireland. It's extremely relevant internationally. And that is that when you're faced with reaction, when you're faced with Tsarism, or you're faced with Cameron's Tories and the onslaught there, or you're faced with the crisis and the attempt to smash the working class that is going on internationally, a kind of reformist alternative is, of course, especially one that's dressed up in left language, is extremely attractive to millions of working class people. And it's a good thing that it is. And the more radical it is in the language, the better. It's much better that people should be in favour of left reformism than that they should be in favour of Blairism. Enormously better. That's all good. But it is not a solution to the crisis of capitalism. On that basis, you cannot actually resolve the international crisis of capitalism. You cannot actually run society in the interests of the working class. There's now there's now a load of experience on this question, much more than when Trotsky wrote. The best we've had from left reformism has been when capitalism was booming, like the 1945 Labour government, and could afford to grant reforms to working people, which they did, while at the same time doing things like building the atom bomb, making war on the colonies, smashing strikes, using the army and so on. But they granted the National Health Service and so on. But that's the best. In a situation of crisis, where reformism leads to is where, you know, Chile, 1973, a coup d'etat and the crushing of the movement, or miserable accommodation and betrayal, like, say, with Pasok in Greece and so on. And that's the same true with left reformism. Trotsky understood this, right, on the basis of what he was seeing in Russia with the Mensheviks and so on. And from that moment onwards, as I said, he was uncompromising on the question of building the party. He did it for the whole of his life, no matter how difficult the circumstances were. And I think I'm coming in under time, which is very good, but I want to quote Trotsky on this. This is from The Lessons of October, which he wrote after the failure of the German Revolution. The German Revolution, the opportunity to spread the revolution from Russia, to spread it to Germany, which would have changed the whole of world history, was missed in 1923, October 1923. So The Lessons of October, as the book, meant the lessons of the October Revolution and how they applied to missing the revolutionary opportunity in Germany. And this is what he wrote. If the triumphant revolution did not come at the end of the war, the end of the First World War, it was because a party was lacking. Right, this conclusion applies to Europe as a whole. He goes on to say, without a party, apart from a party, over the head of a party, or with a substitute for a party, the proletarian revolution cannot conquer. This is the principal lesson of the last decade, the principal lesson of all, and that is the greatest revolutionary wave that we've experienced in history up to this point in time. The principal lesson of that was that you could not win without a party. Their side is organized, centralized, and strategizes. Our side has to be organized, centralized, and strategized. And that, I paraphrase slightly there, and that, he says, is that is the whole of Hegel and the wisdom of books and the meaning of all philosophy. And as I said, you can always quote people out of context. So as I said this then, so, and but I'm quoting him in context. And the point is, as I said, that he devoted the remaining 17 years of his life till the ice pick from Stalin entered his brain to that goal, and so on. So I think it's fair to say that that was central to his thinking. And that seems central to what we talked about. Just last point I'm going to make on this is, what does that mean? It doesn't mean just growing your gang. Of course, you know, people will ask people to join the SWP if you're not a member as you leave this hall. We want you to join up. We want you to join. So if there's any Irish people here, we want to join the Irish SWP. So it doesn't just mean that. Building the party also means going back to the beginnings of what we're talking about with Marxism and socialism and so on, point that Marx fought for in his time, Trotsky was always in favor of, it means actually also building the party in the working class movement and relating to all the actual struggles of the working class. You do the two together. Both are necessary. Again, look at Egypt. Millions of people moving on the streets. Any revolutionary doesn't relate to that is dead, pointless. You have to relate to that in practice, right? But you also need the politics alongside that, or you end up in a dead end, oscillating between the military and Morsi with no political alternative to go further. They go together. That was absolutely essential for Trotsky, and I think it's essential for us as revolutionary socialists today, and what we have to do this year, next year, and the years to come.
Yes, Stan Keeble from Labour Party Marxist. I'm glad to get a reference from John there. I am a Labour Party member, but I'm actually able to talk freely in the Labour Party for what it's worth. They're not kicking me out. Isn't that amazing? I thought the last point about the party question, you know, the emphasis on party question, absolutely essential. But it goes together with programme, doesn't it? Manifesto of the Communist Party that everybody loves is the, you know, not just a manifesto, it's a programme for a party. And I think that making a party and making a programme is the same thing, essentially. You organise around a definite political programme. But the SWP doesn't have one. And that amazes me. That really holds you back, I think. I wanted to say that with the First International, some people quote the First International and say, look, there's all sorts of funny people in it because it had lots of different political tendencies. Marx did not create the First International. He joined it when it formed. And Marx had already drawn the same conclusion that John quotes from Trotsky, that party is essential. The working class needs its own party and its own programme. Lastly, the ice pick. The ice pick is the ultimate weapon of bureaucratic centralism, isn't it? How do you end a debate? You stick the ice pick in the brain. There's no more discussion from the other side. Thank you.
After this comrade, we'll have the comrade who indicated just there. Yeah. If you can come to the front to be ready, that'd be great.
Yeah, John mentioned many books that Trotsky wrote, and I think the one he mentions in terms of the history of the Russian Revolution. Oh, not usually a problem I have. One of the ones that John mentions, the history of the Russian Revolution, is such a fantastic piece of work in terms of the detail of what took place in that year. The sense of the crisis from above is so brilliantly outlined by Trotsky. There's a fantastic opening part where he talks about the Tsar's diaries through those initial stages and not having a clue what was going on. The crisis at the top and how that infected the crisis from below, I think, is a fantastic piece of work. And I think one of the brilliance of Trotsky, really, is the way in which he understood the mood of the masses, that when they are thrown into struggle, that actually people don't move politically in a uniform manner. They actually test out different political organisations. That actually they don't move en masse to the most revolutionary organisations, but those organisations have to be in the centre of the resistance, working alongside other people, but with independence. This is the key question from the question of the Russian Revolution, in my opinion. It is the key lesson of October. Without an independent revolutionary party, situated in the heart of the struggle, there is a fundamental block in terms of having the breakthrough. And I think one of the tragedies of Trotsky, in a sense, is the fantastic writings on the question of the growth of the Nazis. They're very concrete about what should have happened in the left, how Hitler could have been stopped, how actually the whole tide of world history, in a sense, could have been turned around, and he had hardly anybody to implement it. That was the contradiction. Brilliant writings, but with no forces on the ground to implement that strategy to actually stop what was about to take place. And we cannot have a situation, whether it's in Britain or anywhere else, where we are commentating on events in the hope that we could do something with not the forces. Whether we build the forces in the here and now really matters about the way in which things are developed. And the last point about programme. I don't think what's held back revolutionary organisations is programmes. It's the lack of working class struggle. It's objective reality has held us back, not some abstract formula. If only life was so simple. I wish if we could just put up a 10-point programme and everyone would join us. You know, I'm all for it. But there is no substitute. You know, the programmes of the Bolsheviks in 1917, you know, we're predicated on the actual consciousness of people in there and actually a concrete explanation of how we were going to get out of the war, how we were going to get out of starvation. You know, bread, peace and man, all power to the Soviets. That was the programme. It wouldn't have been right to raise that probably in 1913. In 1917 was absolutely correct.
John listed about eight things he said you had to be a Trotskyist today. What interests me, and this is a question, is how many of us are actually distinctively Trotskyist? Apart from the analysis of fascism and permanent revolution, which is obviously his key contribution, I'm not sure that any of those are things that are particularly associated with Trotsky. Internationalism, the need for a party, defensive liberation movements and so on, are all elements of the Marxist tradition which pre-exist Trotsky and which he carried on. And perhaps his greatest achievement was actually to hand those things down to us and maintain the link with that with those theories and those positions. We didn't invent them. And actually, it's quite possible for people to come up with those positions of, for example, socialist revolution in the global south without having heard of permanent revolution. It's a conclusion you come to without reading Trotsky, and many people do. Incidentally, I'd probably like to add to that list the theory of an even combined development, which John didn't mention, which actually seems to underpin the concept of permanent revolution and is absolutely vital to it. So I think there's, you know, yes, to do all those things, you need to be a revolutionary to do the things John said. I agree with all those things, I'm just not sure what's particularly Trotsky's about a lot of them. The second thing is, I don't think the Trotskyist tradition is complete. The international socialist tradition, which seems to be immersed from, actually had to radically break with many of Trotsky's positions and had to bring in other thinkers in order to revise his positions. McCarran in the case of state capitalism, Grossman and various American thinkers, notion of the burnt arms economy. So it has to be enriched with thinkers, not just of Trotsky himself or the people who preceded him, but other people as well to deepen and, if you like, correct some of the positions he had. Trotsky doesn't particularly have a theory of reformism or reformist consciousness. And if you read his books, it's all about the treachery of trade union officials and super profits of imperialism, bribing layers of workers and so on. You get some Lenin, it's wrong. And we have to supplement that with Gramsci, with Lukács, with other thinkers who are not Trotskyists. So although I've got a problem describing myself as a Trotskyist, identify where I come from and put my opposition to Stalinism and so on, I think it's also important to say this is not a complete tradition. It's something we have to add to deepen it, to enrich it, and make it a fully rounded revolutionary position.
Some bits I find a little bit confusing about Trotsky. I think it's mainly that I've probably heard a lot from people that belittle him, is the only way I could actually put it. I'm just wondering if you could recommend any readings that I could actually get a proper handle on him.
Thanks. Yeah, someone, a comrade a moment ago, alluded to the history of the Russian Revolution, which is just a sort of mind-blowing, unbelievable book. And at the heart of it is the sensitivity and the incredible analysis of the disintegrating ruling class, that czar that is writing, in his diaries about that he's going to go on a boating lake, you know, as he's being literally deposed at that very moment. And at the same time, a working class that simply cannot continue in the old way. And it's all about a deep sensitivity to the specific conditions in Russia at that time. You know, John sort of piled up all the incredible, achievements of Trotsky in his sort of armoured train as this incredible revolutionary. But the question is, you know, what is one of his key achievements? And I think it is about preserving the continuity of Marxism against Stalinism. But if we're going to talk about being Trotskyist today, we have to ask what that actually means. John alluded to Trotsky's predictions in 1938. He predicted, you know, the imminent demise of the Soviet Union and Stalinism, the end of capitalism is nigh, and all the rest of it. And as a result, predicted that his tiny sort of embryonic Fourth International would be able to very rapidly take control, you know, sort of lead the coming sort of workers' revolution, and it didn't happen. John, in his book, which I'd really recommend to people, Marxism and the Party, if I can paraphrase this rightly from memory, talks about the fact that Trotsky realised that the key links in the chain, that working class organisation that Trotsky wanted through the Fourth International, was missing, and that the mistake that he made was to kind of substitute these grand rhetorical claims, this theory, for that missing reality. Now, when we come, you know, John and I, many of us in this room, stand in the international socialist tradition and the SWP, what was the biggest compliment that the beginners of that tradition paid to Trotsky after the Second World War? It was to repudiate those mistakes, and it was to break from that tradition. Not to sort of, you know, finger Trotsky for making mistakes, but precisely in order to recognise that to get the essence of Trotskyism and to continue that continuity of Marxism meant to meant to creatively renew the tradition and look at those mistakes and have a concrete analysis going forward. That's what led to the theory of permanent revolution being looked at again, and we had the theory of deflective permanent revolution, of state capitalism to deal with the Soviet Union and with the permanent arms economy. And I think we have to look seriously about what it means to renew that tradition today, because what you have is a situation where we've had, as someone already said, the overriding thing that holds revolutionary socialists back is the incredible, exceptional low level of class struggle. And I'm afraid it is exceptional in historical terms. We've had a situation where neoliberalism over 30 years has reconstituted the working class, as capitalism always reconstitutes the working class, while socialist organisation has diminished. And I think there is a time now to do exactly what it is that the real champions of the Marxist tradition have always done in the IS and Trotsky himself, which is really begin from an honest assessment of the situation of the working class today and begin to renew that tradition, which will involve a break from some of those theories as well as a continuity of some of those theories as well.
Hi. I think John did a cracking explanation of both of Trotsky's. I only got 6 points. I know somebody else got 8 points that you had to beat at Trotsky today. But one of the things I'd hoped that we'd get in the meeting was more about how we actually apply Trotsky today and the challenges that we have in looking at how you fight for internationalism, how you're revolutionary socialist today. And John hinted at some of the challenges that we have, and I wanted to ask him maybe to say a little bit more, because he talked a bit about the problems with the United Front. And quite often the Socialist Workers' Party, we always do in United Fronts, you know. And John implied that in some ways it was a real challenge, because actually what Trotsky described was actually about how you involve mass forces making a pull upon the leaders of big parties. Now we have to recognise that the Social Workers' Party is not that mass party, right? No matter how much we wish it to be. And therefore the challenge is how much what we do is actually something that's a nice thing to say, that we're doing United Front Working United Resistance or UAF. Or is it actually a campaign that allows us to better position ourselves in what we're trying to do and how to do that? There's no doubt that when you look at the Stop the War campaign, that was clearly a United Front that brought in mass forces. The other campaigns that you've been involved in are perhaps not quite the same. And perhaps John could expand a bit more on that bit and how we can perhaps take that forward.
Mine is quite a straightforward question, I think. Certainly before 1989, the distinction between Stalinists and Trotskyists was where you placed yourself in relation to the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc. And I'm very poorly read on Trotsky, but what I'd just like to get your ideas about is, in the kind of post-Soviet era, the key defining difference between Trotskyists and Stalinists, it would seem to me to be how we work with reformist forces, and the issue of the United Front. But is, what would you say is the key defining difference?
John talked a lot about many of Trotsky's brilliant writings, and one of my favourite of Trotsky's writings, partly because of my particular area of research and particular interest, is a pamphlet he wrote in the 1930s called Their Morals and Ours. The context of this is essentially a debate with a whole, in a period where, you know, fascism's on the rise, a period of reaction, various people attempting really to supplement Marxism with essentially non-Marxist theories of morality, with some kinds of Kantian ideas and various other things. At the same time, other people very crudely arguing that really Marxism was just about whatever served the needs of the revolution in some kind of abstract sense and was using it to justify all sorts of horrors under Stalin. The beauty of modern technology means that I've managed to dig out some passages just while I was listening, some of my favourite passages, just to check that I've got them absolutely right. One of the things Trotsky says in that pamphlet is that permissible and obligatory are those and only those means which unite the revolutionary proletariat, fill their hearts with irreconcilable hostility to oppression, teach them contempt for official morality and its democratic echoers, imbue them with consciousness of their own historic mission, raise their courage and spirit of self-sacrifice in the struggle. Later, he adds, the liberation of the workers can come only through the workers themselves. There is therefore no greater crime than deceiving the masses, palming off defeats as victories, friends as enemies, bribing workers' leaders, fabricating legends, staging false trials, in a word, doing what the Stalinists do. And I think the importance of those passages is to indicate the way in which Trotsky indicated that the fundamental role of Marxists, the fundamental role of a revolutionary party, is to empower the working class to be the agent of its own emancipation. And that means it needs to be sensitive to the movements within the working class, the different positions within the working class. It must be scrupulously honest with them, and it must engage with them at every level to empower them to become to empower them to become the agents of their own emancipation. Now, it seems to me the lesson we can take from that, although, you know, I think some of Trotsky's philosophy is rather crude. I think that particular insight is something that has to run through everything we do within a revolutionary organisation today. We have to engage seriously with the questions of what it actually is that empowers the proletariat to become the agent of its own emancipation. We need to be scrupulously honest with ourselves and with the proletariat, and it's only through those kinds of methods that we will create the kind of organisation we need and the kind of society we want.
See, a couple of people, Jack, who spoke earlier, and a few others, have said that we need to refine and develop the tradition handed to us by Trotsky, and I agree with that, but I think it's more valuable for people to say how they want to develop it than simply make invocations to develop it. That doesn't get us very far. You see, I don't think John was saying that we're Trotskyists and that's the end of the story and it solves all our problems. We like to say, and you know, it's an old cliche, that we stand on the shoulders of giants, and there are many giants in our tradition. And indeed, there's another version of that saying that says, if I haven't seen very far, it's because giants were standing on my shoulders. And you feel with some of the Trotskyist tradition, they got as far as Trotsky and the programme and so on, and it stops there. That's not our tradition. Our tradition is to develop the theory. I wanted to say a little bit about Trotsky's method, because Trotsky writes somewhere that the essence of tragedy is the gap between noble aspirations and insufficient means. And he writes it about the degeneration of the Russian Revolution. But Trotsky's own life is the essence of tragedy. Because if you look at his early writings, what infuses them, fill them with theoretical vigour, and make them so innovative, is the extent to which they draw on the real lived struggles of workers. And I think one of the problems Trotsky faces, but far more than that his followers face, is a progressive detachment from those mass struggles of workers, which actually gives Trotskyism its tragic character as it becomes more and more severed from the struggles that give its lifeblood. It's particularly important in Trotsky's development of the theory of permanent revolution, I think. Neil Davidson said that we need to talk about uneven and combined development, and it's true that Trotsky's theory was absolutely tremendously important. What Trotsky is saying is that in a late developing capitalist society like Russia, you get entangled in that society, very modern means of production, a small but very militant working class in the urban centres, alongside backwardness, rural poverty, and an oppressive czarist regime. And these contradictions throw up burning problems for the people that have to be resolved. That's very briefly what the theory of uneven combined development tells us. But it's very important to avoid the trend in a lot of academic Marxism of just talking about uneven and combined development and not talking about Trotsky's conclusion. Trotsky's conclusion, based on the real struggles of workers, was that workers were actually fighting, and as they were fighting, even though they were a minority, the power of their struggles, the power and cohesiveness of their struggles, could draw other oppressed groups behind them, even though those workers were in a minority, and they could impose a revolutionary solution to those problems, which would then run on to a transition towards socialism. Yes, the theory of uneven and combined development, but yes, also the conclusion that draws on the real living struggles of workers of permanent revolution.
Hi, good morning, comrades. I just came from Hong Kong. I just arrived in London last night. It's really my pleasure, great opportunity to join this master's event 2013. Regarding to the what John mentioned, because the I think there's a lot of the good legacy from the Trotsky in the one hand, but of course there's also lots of the controversy and the problems from the legacy of Trotsky, especially the theory of the Trotsky and also the organization who claims they are they inherit the legacy of the Trotskyism. Because on the second hand, there's a lot of the pogroms or the struggle or the factions between those organizations who claim they are Trotskyist organization. That's the one thing. And so the problem is that the most important thing is that Trotsky, when he explained the phenomenon of the Stalinism, of the so-called the degenerate worker states between when he was still in life, this leaves a lot of a problem, especially after he's assassinated by the Stalin's spy about the degenerate worker states. When these theories apply to explain so-called the ex-Stalinist state, but it's more important is that what about the China now? Because for my experience, there's still a lot of so-called Trotskyists. They still so claim that China is still a degenerate worker state. Yes, this is a real situation in Hong Kong. So we have to very make to careful to still this the problem of so-called degenerate worker states. This kind of the theory developed by the Trotsky. I want to ask the John, what do you think of this kind of the theory, especially nowadays for the so-called China? Yeah. So, but for my personal experience, I think it's very. I want to share one sentence from the French, also the Trotsky philosopher Daniel Ben Sa'i, when he wrote a book in a small bookness of Trotskyism. I think it's very good inspiration that for the whole past history of the Trotskyism, he concluded one sentence is that how to be the revolutionaries in the non-revolutionary period. This is the whole the crystals of his books. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, I wanted to just come back to this question around the sort of theory of permanent revolution and how Trotsky got to where he got to with it, because on the eve of the 1905 revolution in Russia, you really have three positions that are put forward, because up until this point, the revolutionary changes that people had seen had been really effectively bourgeois democratic revolutions that had taken place. And again, there was this theory that you had to go through this stage of the democratic revolution then before you could get a mature working class that was then able to take on the question of socialist revolution and carry that forward. And so we have, you know, on the eve of 1905, the Mensheviks, who basically effectively want to line up behind the bourgeoisie, still see these people as being the most, you know, progressive people in society who will actually take forward against Tsarism and actually implement, you know, some form of democratic state. Do you have then Lenin and the Bolsheviks, who actually don't believe for one moment that the bourgeoisie is anything progressive at all, that actually they are a conservative force within society, but actually we will have to go for a democratic revolution before we can start to really establish any form of working class or alternative and fight for socialist revolution. One of the things which I think that Trotsky does with his, when he analyses the uneven and combined development, the way in which he analyses the backwardness of the bourgeoisie, the way in which he analyses the ability of the working class, because, I mean, when you think about uneven combined development, it's remarkable when you think in Russia, the capitalist development, the size of some of the factories in Russia, you're talking 13,000, 14,000 workers sometimes in these factories, and these are huge workplaces. The the concentration of that development there as well, get the sense of economic power that the working class has. Actually, Trotsky understands the ability of that because of his analysis around uneven and combined development for those people to be a leadership within both a democratic revolution, but the ability within that to lead the peasantry and to lead forward on towards a different society and overcome the limitations that are there in democratic revolutions and from such a conservative force with the bourgeoisie as well. But why? Because he understands, I think, the dynamic of development within that society. And therefore, I think when a punk revolution today, when you think about Egypt, you know, an incredible theory that actually we have to be looking towards today. When we actually then start to develop the theory of deflected permanent revolution in the 60s, actually what you start to see, I think, is it's a break from the predictions of Trotsky, but it's not a break from Trotskyism as a method and a way of understanding the different dynamics that are there in society and understanding why certain things are happening at certain times. And again, I think, you know, when you look at Trotsky's theory around the United Front, and you think about how we implement that, and when we don't have the, you know, people talking about the mass parties and so on, the implementation of that is about the understanding of reformism. It's about the understanding of how revolutionaries build unity with people to the right of them in order to carry on and fight back against fascism, building with organisations of comparable size, the tactics and strategies of how we fight back against fascism, how we push towards mass action of people against fascism. I think these are some of the things and some of the stuff, the way in which we start to apply that as well. And so again, I just think that, you know, in terms of, you know, the break and continuity that we talk about all the time, actually it's not a break from the method of Trotskyism, it's a break from different predictions and dogmatism, but actually the application of Trotskyism, I think, is about keeping the Marxist tradition alive, understanding the dynamic of class struggle, and fighting for revolutionary party within that.
Thank you very much. There's a great deal to respond to. First of all, what to read, for the comrade who asked, there's an enormous literature on Trotsky, and an even vaster literature by Trotsky himself. It was estimated that if you actually put all his work together, it comes to about 60 volumes. But where to start? Trotsky's Marxism by Duncan Hallis, I think, is an excellent introduction to start on reading about him. So I recommend particularly that. There's two major biographies that I would recommend. One is by Isaac Deutscher, Profit Armed, Unarmed and Outcast, which is a most wonderful account of Trotsky's life, and beautifully written and absolutely magnificent, one of the great biographies, but a bit politically dodgy at various points. You know, he was a semi-Stalinist, Isaac Deutscher, I think that's... I can't go to that now. There's another biography of Trotsky, which is four volumes by Tony Cliff, which is much less well written, much less magnificent, but politically much better. But that does work. And then there's the vast amount of works by Trotsky, all of which repay reading. And so the problem about the history of the Russian Revolution, which we've all talked about and so on, is simply that it's very long. But say, the lessons of October would be a good short. Okay, right. The question about the difference, you know, in the Soviet era between Stalinists and Trotsky was kind of obvious, and is it not so? That goes very much together, I think, with the question that the comic from Hong Kong asked, which was wonderful contribution to have in this meeting. The first thing I want to say is that the argument about Russia and was Russia socialist was, of course, an argument about what attitude do you take to this regime and so on. But it's also a fundamental argument about the nature of socialism. What is the essence of socialism? Can you have socialism just because you've got state ownership without workers' power and workers' democracy? That is at the heart. That argument doesn't go away. That argument also applies to the question of social democracy that might carry out some nationalisation, but retain the capitalist state and so on. That's relevant to that. Also, although the Soviet Union collapsed, the phenomenon of Stalinism still there in many parts of the world, and there are still significant Stalinist movements. We don't like to call it that because it's Eurocopies and so on, but Syriza comes out of Stalinism and so on. It wears a different face, But actually, someone like Tsipras, the leader of them, he's not a new phenomenon. His politics are Euro-communist. They're the politics of the Popular Front developed, and so we need to understand that. And of course, it relates particularly in the Far East in various ways. And this bears also of the difference between the international socialist tradition and Trotsky as well. I mean, if you take purely state property as the criteria here, which is what Stalinists do fundamentally at the bottom, then of course, it's on my mind because I'm going there, sure, I'll be to South Korea, but North Korea is a worker state because it's got state property and so on. And North Korea, which is a hideous dictatorship, I'm going to South Korea because I went to North Korea, they'd shoot me, you know, without a doubt, and it's an absolute disaster. But that's your worker state that you have the support if you just go on state property. So there's a fundamental issue. I think the question of China is very interesting in this, and of huge significance. If Orthodox Trotskyists, as they like to call themselves, still argue that China is a worker state, then they are just closing their eyes to reality in the name of dogma. I mean, what else can you say? But it is significant in terms of the flaw in Trotsky's position that China was able to evolve from, you know, a so-called Maoist communist regime to what it is today without a revolution, gradually for the ruling class to move sideways to embrace capitalism as fully as they had done. That's a significant weakness in their position. I'll come back to that. I'll say it now. There was some playing with the metaphor about standing on the shoulders of giants, and so the we can see far because we stand on the shoulders of giants actually comes from Isaac Newton, and the completion of it that I like is the one from Cliff, which says we can see far because if we stand on the shoulders of giants, on one condition, that we open our eyes. And that, I think, you would want to say to the Chinese Trotskyists, you know, who think China's still a worker state, open your eyes. It seems to me. The Labour Party Marxist, I would want to reply to with a couple of points. First of all, yeah, they let you say what you want. But if you were organised and a problem for them, they would soon stop letting you say what they want. Remember what happened to the militant tendency, for example, and so on. You know, I'm sorry, but the fact they let you say what you want means you're not really a problem for them. Not on that question. The question about the programme. The programme and building the party are the same thing. No, they're not. I wish. If building the party and having the correct programme were the same thing, Hitler would have been defeated in Germany. Trotsky had a wonderful programme for fighting fascism. He didn't have the forces to do it. I'm sorry, but they just aren't the same thing. You know, the Communist Manifesto, using the Communist Manifesto as an example, this is a mistake. What's brilliant about the Communist Manifesto is not its 10-point programme at the end. It's the sweeping outline of the whole of world history and the last 500 years, the explanation of the fundamentals of the proletarian struggle. That's what's brilliant about that. There's a 10-point programme at the end that soon went out of date and Marx stopped bothering about. That's not the brilliant part of it, and so on. And going back to the First International as the model, I think it's fundamentally mistaken. The First International was an enormous step forward for the movement then, but it was before modern reformism developed. And so the problem which arises in Germany with social democracy and international social democracy and so on, and that none of the Marxists, Marx and Engels didn't understand, because it hadn't happened yet. But that's what, as I tried to say with Trotsky and Lenin and so on, that's what that came out of. So I didn't really agree with the comrade but on those points. I want to come to the whole question that a number of people raised about developing the tradition and so on. Very interesting question about the United Front that actually was based on something I had said on this. Look, I think people sometimes get in a muddle about the United Front. And they get in the muddle about the United Front because they start by saying the way to understand the United Front is to read what Trotsky said about it and then say, does this, this, or this fit that model? I think it's the wrong way around. Right, Trotsky didn't invent the United Front, as he would have told you. There was, you know, there were United Fronts before Trotsky used the term. Right, there was a United Front in the Russian Revolution, actually of a kind, between the Bolsheviks and Kerensky against Kornilov and the fascists. They didn't call it that. But that doesn't matter. You start from something that is in Marx and is in the Communist Manifesto, right? And that is that you need to unify the working class and be part of the workers' movement against the bourgeoisie. And at the same time, you have to have an understanding of the overall line of Marx. You start from that and you develop bit beyond that and apply it. Now, I said in relation to fascism, we have to fight fascism. Is it a united front or a campaign? Well, pose it concretely, right? You've got to fight the BNP or the EDL, right? You can sit around worrying whether we've got a united front, like Trotsky said, or it's only a campaign. Basically, it's going to get you nowhere. What you have to do is to try and mobilize the maximum number of people, right? From the movement, you don't make an alliance with the capitalist state or the bourgeoisie against fascism, because that will hold you back. But you have to look at how you can mobilise the maximum number of forces from our side and our class against them. If that means you call it Unite Against Fascism, or you call it, you know, whatever, Burnley Against the This, or whatever, you do what fits to achieve the aim in that situation. That's applying it. Concrete, because you have to. You have to understand how you do that. Concrete. Now that of course is complex. I just do not have time, and it's not. I'm not in a good position because I'm living in Ireland and so on to talk about the details of the Unite the Resistance and how we do it in each situation. But the principle we can explain. Now, on the question of developing the tradition, I make. Several points. First of all, just a small point to Dan Swain about Trotsky's philosophy being a bit crude. I actually used to believe that, and I wrote it in a fairly long book on this, but that was before I read Trotsky's philosophical notebooks that he wrote in the 30s that were not published and so on, and I came to the conclusion I was mistaken on that. So you might want to revisit that. Well, he wasn't that. He wasn't. Some of the individual expressions, but that's true of Lenin, that's true of everybody, and so on. To Neil, I would say, again, the spirit that we need to develop theory, of course, this is always true. Right, this is true of not just of Trotskyism, but of Marxism as a whole. It's a developing theory, always in response to challenges in the real, in the real world. It has to be absolutely. That's true, of course. But again, I didn't really agree with completely with the way he posed things. About are these ideas distinctively Trotskyist? I thought it was the wrong way. It was like, who are we crediting with it, inventing things? And I don't think that's the point. If you take, is being a proletarian revolutionary distinctively Trotskyist? No, there was also Lenin, though indeed there was Marx and Engels and so on, of course. And millions of people we hope would be proletarian revolutionary. The fact is, though, this is the point, that history turned out that it was Trotskyism that embodied being proletarian revolutionary in history at that time. Right, and that's what we build on. So I think it is reasonable to say that is what it's about being a Trotskyist today, and the same with a number of other questions. I don't think it's, you know, which book did you read to get it? You know, you could say, well, yeah, there was Marx, and he read all these books. So, you know, I don't think that's the right way to pose the question. I think, and this is really that the international socialist tradition has developed Trotskyism, and it was always consciously a development of Trotskyism in many different ways, and that really is the subject of the meeting that I'm doing next this evening. on the international socialist tradition. So I will follow up with that. But I would just say that with this, you do have to be careful because you develop theory. Not all developments in theory are good. Many developments in theory are fundamentally wrong, and they can be in response to not the working class struggle, but to other influences and other pressures. So you can say, for example, we're going to develop our theory of organization, and we're going to learn from anarchism and autonomism and so on. That's where it's at. That, and it can sound ever so new, but it doesn't make it correct. Because I would argue, and I wrote a little book on anarchism to say this, that those theories and ideas can't win, and history proves they can't win. So that's a development that's not in the right direction. I'm very opposed to, and it wasn't spelled out here, but I'm very opposed to the argument that we need to revise our view of the working class as the agent of socialist change in any way that is starting to say that there are no, it's other forces, it's the precariat or it's somebody else, or it's not really the employed workers at the centre of it, or it's not really, we should move away from the public sector workers to the... I haven't got time to go into those, but I don't think those are correct. I don't think they're correct in Britain, I don't think they're correct internationally. Yes, there's been a low level of struggle in Britain, but hang on a minute, open your eyes. There is not a low level of struggle in the world at the moment, which is where we should start from. And are we saying, when we say there's been a low level of struggle in Britain, that we couldn't have a high level of struggle in Britain with a low level of struggle in Ireland? We don't start from the fact there can't be a high level of struggle in Ireland. I think it's perfectly possible that in the next year, 2-3 years, you could have a high level of struggle in Britain, as you've had in Brazil, Turkey, and so on. So I think I'd be worried about those theories. So I just end with something else about today. It's a rhetorical point, if you like, but it's always in my mind when I think about Trotsky and Trotskyism today. And that is his last sort of written words in his testament, when he said, life is beautiful, let future generations cleanse it of all oppression and ugliness. We are those future generations. That is our task, is to essentially save humanity and the future from the barbarism that is capitalism.